Welcome back. We'll be starting with the fourth set for the expected questions in education for your November 2017 NET examination. Although we said that we'll be covering only three sets, I found some of the topics really important. So we are covering one more class for the same. Now the first section that we'll talk about talks about digital classroom, flipped classroom and blended learning. So there is difference between these three terms, which is very, very important. Therefore, digital classroom is a kind of technologically enabled classroom where you have ICT, information and communication technology, as part of your teaching. However, under flipped classroom, what happens is before you enter the classroom, you are shown some video or some audio. By means of audiovisual instructions, you are shown something and then you are moved to the classroom for discussions. And what happens is, prior to the class, the actual class, you have some discussion that goes on, and that is known as flipped classroom, and that discussion is in the form of the audiovisual interaction that you have. On the other hand, you have the blended learning. Now this blended learning includes the online instructions along with the face-to-face communication. So it includes both face-to-face communication and online learning. So these are the three different ways of actual learning that we talk about in today's time, where we talk about more on a kind of smart classes and smart education. So you have the digital classroom. As we know, it's ICT enabled. You have digital infrastructure. You have all the archives which are in the digital form, the books in the digital form. It helps to accommodate new equipments, and it's basically a kind of virtualized classroom. So that's what is digital learning as we are right now doing. Now flipped classroom, inverted classroom and reverse instruction, as we said. So here the content is being exposed prior to the classroom session, and you have a kind of audiovisual online interaction, and then you move to the class, and that is known as flipped classroom or inverted classroom or reverse instruction. And finally, besides all these, you have some other tools which are commonly used in today's education. So till now, the commonly used tools were kind of transparency slides. Then you moved on with projector. You had the computers for presentation, screens and so on. Now a few other terminologies that are gaining momentum nowadays. First is clickers. Clickers are the response systems by the students. So what happens is, the student attends the class and then he is asked to poll about the teacher, about the content and so on. So those are known as clickers. The next is e-portfolio. E-portfolio is a kind of online collection. So when we talk about portfolio, in case of drawings, you have a collection of the drawings that you have made. Similarly, e-portfolio is an online collection that the students have, and he can demonstrate his skills by the same. The next is LMS, that's learning management systems. Now these allow the instructions, the instructional material. It can be in the form of text, it can be audio visual or any other form, and it basically helps in peer-to-peer interaction. So it increases the learning frequencies. The next is wikis. Wikis are the collaborative websites which have the content, and those are available online. Now this is different from blogs. Wikis can be edited by anyone on the web page. However, blogs narrate the kind of online work that you have done. So there is a person who would write his own blog and another person who would write his own blog. Other person cannot come and edit the blog. Vimba is very, very important. It's known as the web-based meeting. Now, web-based meeting means, if you are in an industry, you are having a meeting, that means there are 5 or 6 people gathered together to discuss on certain topic. However, under Vimba, the same meeting occurs on a web-based tool. So you have an online tool, which is a kind of live chat or audio content that is being displayed under the Vimba. The next is podcast. Now under podcast, you have the audio and the audio visual files. Those are allowed to be downloaded on the computer, and you can view those later on. Simulations mean you are trying to imitate the real life. For example, a pilot, when he is being trained for the training of a pilot, what was done is, he is actually not on the first day asked to sit into an aeroplane and go. So he is given a simulation training. That means that there is similar situation being created on the ground on a kind of system, and then he is asked to work around that and finally move on to the real planes. The next is the smart boards. Smart boards are interactive whiteboards, and what is happening here is the touch technology is being detected. So you have the keyboard inputs that are being detected here. Now the next is sections model. Sections model was given by Bates and Poole in 2003, and this represents the idea to select what instructional technology should be used. So this word sections talks about different terms. So S for students, E for the ease of use, C for the cost, T for teaching, I for the level of interaction, O for the organizational issues, N for novelty, and S for speed. Now next two projects, very very important, Gyankunj and Namo eTab. Gyankunj has been released as a dummy project in the state of Gujarat, specifically for class 7th and 8th now, and this would be spread to classes 5 to 9 if it's successful later on. Now this talks about developing smart classrooms with projectors, with Wi-Fi, camera, routers, laptops, and the idea is to increase the interest among the students to develop more of audiovisual content. Now the total expenditure is assumed at 35 crores, of which it would be around 2,22,000 for every school. It would be implemented in 3,000 classrooms in 1,600 schools. The next is Namo eTab. Now this word is an abbreviation for New Avenues of Modern Education Through Tablets. This is again an initiative by Gujarat government. The idea is to provide the college students with tablets. Now the original cost of the tablet is around 8,000. They are provided at a subsidized rate of 1,000. The idea is to develop voice calling, study material, everything through the tablets, and these tablets are being developed by Acer and Lenovo. Till now nearly 1.5 lakh students have registered for the same. Now seven principles of good teaching are very very important that are being recently discussed. So first is the student faculty contact. The next is collaborative learning, active learning, feedback from the students, learners from different background, high expectation, and finally the time on the task. So they are given certain tasks, and how much time they spend on the task is again very important. Now after the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, we still felt that there were nearly 70 to 80 lakh students in India who are not part of the education system. So based on that, the new scheme has been started, which is known as School Chalo Abhiyan, and the idea is to provide 100% literacy. Pre-independence in 1947, the literacy rate was only 18%, which jumped out to the present 81%. Still, we have a huge way to go, and all these 70 to 80 lakh students should be covered under the basic education system. It also includes moving forward with digital education, specifically in the rural areas, and 100% literacy by 2022. So that's again a very important scheme. Again, similar to that, we had the National Literacy Mission. In the literacy mission, we talk about acquiring the skills for reading, writing, and these are based on certain parameters. So self-reliance, awareness, acquiring new skills, and imbibing values are the key aspects. Now there are two terms that are commonly used. One is the crude literacy rate, and other is the effective literacy rate. When we talk about crude literacy rate, it's the number of literate people divided by the total population. Under effective literacy rate, we talk about literate people above the age of 7 years divided by total population above the age of 7 years. So that's the difference between the crude literacy rate and effective literacy rate. Now the next is the world rankings for the worldwide rankings for the universities. So 2018, you had IISc, which was ranked highest from India. Now there are different universities. The first one was Oxford, then Cambridge, and finally California. From India, you had 30 universities that were selected. None of the universities came in top 100. 8 featured in top 500 and 3 featured in top 200. Those are IIT Delhi, IIT Bombay and IISc Bangalore. Now, what are the reasons why Indian universities are not at par with the foreign universities? Some of the basic reasons include lack of research funds that are being allocated to the universities. The universities are not able to internationalize themselves. Then some of the universities cater to only a particular stream, let's say engineering or management, and therefore they are trying to reduce the volume and the variety. The next is the government policy is limiting the number of intake of the foreign candidates. So that's again very, very important. Now this performance was calculated on 5-point basis. This included teaching with 30% weightage, research with 30% weightage, you have citations with 30%, international outlook with 7.5% and industrial income with 2.5% weightage. However, there are certain exclusions that the universities which do not teach undergraduate courses or whose research output is amounted to less than 1000 articles are not considered in this listing. The next is Swachhata ranking for educational institution. Now we already know about the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan and the developments going on there. So based on that, this Swachhata ranking has been done for the higher educational institutions in India. The idea is to save water and electricity, provide more cleanliness and manage the waste. So we already know there are around 4 crore 80 lakh toilets that have been constructed and more than 2 lakh villages which have been declared ODF. Now these are the parameters under which we talk about in the Swachh ranking for the universities or the educational institutions. Now these are the points that you must go through. We'll have those handouts on the website so you can refer those. And then you have the ranking based on different categories. So among the universities, you have OP Jindal University of Sonipat, which ranked first. In the colleges, you had the Kongu Arts College in Erode that topped. Technical institutions, Amrita Vishwa Vidyapitam was the most clean technical institution. Then under government institution, you had GB Pant University of Agriculture and Technology in Pantnagar, Uttarakhand. Now the next is very, very important, the zero tolerance policy by UGC. This policy has been released to check plagiarism in any form. So if the publishing work is found to be copied from some other source, it would be disqualified. Now there are various levels under which they have given the parameters. Firstly, the annual increment of the candidate would be denied, and the supervising authority could also be disqualified for the same. Now all the higher educational institutions will need to submit the soft copy of their work to InfLibNet, that's the Information and Library Network, for the MPhil and the PhD thesis, so that they can quickly check out if there is any plagiarism and the percentage of plagiarism. Again, this is a part of the Shodh Ganga e-repository where the thesis would be the part of the digital repository. Now there are three levels. The first level, that is the lowest level, so the person would be denied for the research work for 1 year, and the manuscript would have to be withdrawn. If it's level 2, he would be denied for 2 years and one annual increment would go, and he would not be allowed to be supervisor to any student for a period of 2 years. Under level 3, the manuscript would be withdrawn for 3 years, he would be denied 2 increments, and he would not be allowed to supervise any further candidate for 3 years. So those are the frameworks that have come up. Very, very important, the zero tolerance policy. The next is NAC revised framework. Now NAC is the body that rates the various educational institutions. The parameter on which it is ranking has been revised. Now it is a collaboration of the system generated scores, which are 70% online and 30% for peer evaluation. Minimum of 3.01 grade has been given for criteria 1, 2 and 3, and based on that you have the grades that have been allotted. So range of 3 and above is under grade A, which is very good performance, and all below that have been mentioned here. This have been come along on the 7 criterias that have been considered by NAC. These are the curriculum, the teaching levels, the research levels, the infrastructure facility, the governance in the university and the campus, the innovations and the student support. So based on this, you have the NAC revised committee, the NAC revised framework that has come up. So with this, we cover the yet another important sections on education. Please note, we have already covered three of the classes on expected questions on education, which are very, very important. Definitely go through them. And one class on the digital reforms in India, where we have talked about the major computer terminologies, which is again very important for your upcoming NET examination. Do subscribe to the channel. We'll be bringing in more updates before your examination. Have a good day ahead.